Thank you for joining us, Dr. Gill. To start with, your reaction to the West Bengal government's policy for phase three vaccination. What are your concerns? You will have to return your stocks to the government and procure vaccinations directly from manufacturers. What difficulties do you anticipate?
So, Monideepa, you know, till now, the system was going on perfectly well and smoothly. I'll just explain how it worked. Every morning, we used to deposit an X amount of money in the account. We used to collect the vials. During the course of the day, we could vaccinate approximately 250 to 300 people, depending on your bandwidth. And by evening, if there were any vials, deposit them back or keep them for the next day. But you have to keep on accounting for every vial. So this is a model which we've been following all this while. Worked very well. Now, yesterday we've got a notification which says that with effect from 1st of May, we will not be able to procure vaccinations through the government channel. We will have to directly get in touch with the manufacturers based out of Pune and Hyderabad, depending on whatever we want to buy, and get it from them and start dispensing vaccinations. Now, this is where the complication sets in. Now, if standalone hospitals were to start approaching Serum Institute, I don't think we have got much of a leeway with them to be getting vaccinations as per our requirement. Secondly, some of our colleagues have approached them and we were given to understand that there is a 5-month waiting period. They are committed to a lot of other countries, a lot of other governments of state governments. So it's said it's a 5-month waiting period. Now the problem is 1st May onwards, you're all aware that 18 plus age bracket is going to kick in. So what happens is while the amount of people who are going to come and avail this facility is going to substantially increase, we're going to substantially decrease the number of facilities which are dispensing vaccines. So we are in a bit of a catch-22 situation here. We were ramping up our facilities in terms of anticipating more crowds 1st May onwards. So we were all set. Now, this has come as a bit of a spanner in what we were planning. We have appealed to the government to look into it and continue the status quo or the existing model. We are happy to pay if there is a commercial upside in the price of the vial. Now, currently, we are buying it at 150, selling it at 250, 100 rupees, taking care of our logistics and other costs. So if tomorrow, if the government were to decide, let's proposition or price it at 500, we're fine to do that also, as long as people are availing the good facility. Also, another challenge I foresee is that if 1st May onwards, it's only the government hospitals which are going to be the dispensing centers, we will have a situation where there are thousands of people, senior citizens, youngsters, in queues outside these hospitals, throwing the social distancing norm to the winds. So that's, I mean, people would be coming to get vaccinated. They run the risk of getting COVID from that situation. So that's where we have to figure out what to do.
Sounds grim. Did you say that your initial inquiries with the Serum Institute and other manufacturers, you heard that there's a waiting period of 5 whole months?
So these are unconfirmed reports, but some of our colleagues from other private organizations have reached out to their marketing teams and where they've been told that it's a very, very long waiting period. So if this decision isn't reversed, 1st May onwards, all the private hospitals will have to shut shop as far as vaccination centers are concerned.
Let me just move on to the other big crisis that is facing us. How do you rate the situation in Bengal vis-a-vis, or rather Calcutta specifically, vis-a-vis the situation in Delhi? Are we almost in the same boat or are we a little better off?
No, as of today, we are better off. You know, be it the oxygen situation, be it the situation as far as beds is concerned, we are not as bad as we are in Delhi. I am in touch with my colleagues in Delhi and Bombay pretty much every day, all the time. The Delhi situation is very bad. So I think one of the smarter things we've done in Calcutta, and I must compliment the government in terms of leading us on that, is these satellite centers being very, very proactive in terms of wherever a course correction is to be required while we're doing a particular thing. So if I were to give you my hospital, CMRI's example, we've been ramping up beds over the last few weeks. fairly periodically. So every couple of days, we would ramp it up by 20 to 25. So today we are 60% of this 350-bed hospital is a COVID hospital, COVID-allocated hospital. The balance 40% is for non-COVID patients. And that's what all other private players have also been doing. We've also got ourselves a satellite center, which is a sort of a step-down unit. People who do not need hospitalization and oxygen can be parked there before they are sent home. So 30, 40 beds are over there. It takes care of some critical patients who need a hospital bed. So that means we are fine. We are jammed with calls pretty much the whole day in terms of waiting lists, beds required, but we are able to manage. We are not sending people back. We are able to, in a few hours of a stay in an isolation area or a holding area, we are able to manage beds and all. But what is in store, basis reports, basis some scientific data, if May was to turn worse than April, then we are in for a bit of a problem. I mean, this is a rubber band. Beyond a point, if you stretch it, it's going to break. So while system so far, I don't know whether we'll be able to carry on for this for beyond a point. Also, another critical issue which we often miss is the staff. Nursing on expanding beds while we keep on setting up halls and put hundreds over there. Who's going to look after those patients? So there is a limitation and a bandwidth issue as far as nursing and clinical staff is concerned. So even our nurses are falling to COVID. They're all across the industry. There are healthcare workers who are again falling to COVID. Having said, it's not very bad since most of us are vaccinated. The positivity rate is much, much less as last vis-a-vis what we saw last year. But it's a challenge. Increasing beds is one issue. Complementing those with nursing support, you must tackle.
Hold on. One second. I need to do something. One moment, please. I have a slight issue. One second, sir. I have a call I just have to take. Right, I think now it's better. Yeah, can you hear me? All okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Next point. You mentioned the point of human resources. The other question, of course, I had for you is, you said everything is more or less under control as of now. What about oxygen? What about remdesivir? What about beds? I mean, you said you are not sending anybody back, but oxygen and remdesivir. What is the situation?
So the oxygen situation is not as bad as we've been witnessing in Delhi. We've got about 2 days of oxygen backup in our hospitals. We are getting regular supply. We are also ramping up our storage capacity. So it's not the time to press the crisis button as far as oxygen is concerned. On remdesivir, we were really badly off till about 5-6 days back. Now there has been a little comfort, and there is a little stock which is coming in. But would you say, if you were to ask me, are we sorted? No, remdesivir continues to be a challenge. Not as bad as we were last one a week back. But I would still say that's a red flag. And the third thing you asked was beds. You know, Mohandeepa, if I were to add another 100 beds in this hospital, let's say by this evening, they would get filled up in the next 48 hours. And that's the same story across the town. So we must also see that internally as a hospital administrators, that who gets the bed and who gets discharged. So there is a lot of panic get admission, and there's a lot of people, just wanting to be in a hospital where they're next to an oxygen cylinder and all that. So all of that has to be managed sensibly and rationally by the clinicians also, which we are trying to do.
That is the key question though. How many HDU or ICU beds do you have? I was looking at the figures altogether. We have just less than 2,000 HDU ICU beds in the state, according to the government.
No, so we have, of these 205 beds which have been allocated to COVID, of these 85 5 are ICU and HDU beds. So approximately 40-odd% of our beds are HDU. Now, that's also the general norm and ratio of a multi-speciality tertiary care hospital. Across, it's a thumb rule. The thumb rule of if you have 100 beds, 40-odd%, 35 to 40% beds are your ICU. So that's the norm we are following. Now, we have also tried to convert some of our single and double rooms into HDUs by placing monitors. So people who do not really require to be in ICUs but still need some sort of monitors, we've got our monitors on rentals, on from spare monitors from other places, and position them in rooms, which we can. We are now trying to label them as single room HDUs. So people who need to be in single. So that, you know, we're trying various permutation and combinations, and it's a situation which changes every morning. So that's where we are.
One more question, and then I'll let you go. RT-PCR. You all are also testing in your hospital.
Yeah.
Is there a crisis? Because there are dozens of calls we get for RT-PCR bookings. And then apparently bookings are only coming through in about 3 or 4 days, and then results over another 72 hours. So by the time you have tested, it's a week gone.
No. So first of all, we've not been into home collections. Some of the standalone labs have been doing home collections. Now they've stopped. One of the reasons they've stopped is most of their home collection staff has fallen to COVID. So we in CMRI have 4 different platforms, starting from a GeneXpert to a TrueNAT to an Abbott. In normal times, our turnaround time would have been just about 3 hours, not more than that. Now it's slightly extended and it's gone up by 5 to 6 hours since the number of tests which are running in for in-house patients and OPDs are high. But anybody who comes in into CMRI, gives a sample, let's say by 12 noon, would get his or report by evening, 5 to 6, 6.30 in the day, not later than that. So, but yeah, the key is that people have to come here and give their samples. There is no home collection happening. But you're right, the home collection guys are in a bit of a problem as far as turnaround time is concerned.
And, you know, what is the percentage of people who are testing positive when they come to your hospital for testing? Some hospitals are reporting 50% of people coming in for tests are testing positive in Kolkata.
So the percentage is fairly high, not 50% with us, in the range of 40-ish, 40 plus minus. But you know, you have to see that people who come for testing are also the people who developed symptoms. So if you get a very low positivity rate, then also there's something wrong with the model which you are following. So people who are being advised by various GPs, their family doctors, are people who require testing. And let's accept the fact that it is in the air, it is in the community. For 30, 40, 50% people will test positive who walk up to get tested. So that's a reality, and it's a hard reality. Not much can be done about it.
And the bottom line is, we are yet to catch up with Delhi on the horror story that is unfolding
there. I don't want to catch up with Delhi. We do not want to catch up with Delhi. Delhi is gone totally berserk. I hope and pray Calcutta never ever comes in the news for all those reasons. Delhi has been in the news over the last 2 weeks. So far, so good. We've managed it well. The government has been extremely cooperative. The guidance has been excellent. And I hope we can carry that trend.
But you are concerned that once May begins and the result of all the election campaigning hits us, things may...
That's something which is making us lose our sleep every night. You know, we are all very worried about that.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gill. I'm good. Thanks very much.
I'll get back
to you on whenever...
Thank you. Take care and stay safe.
Thanks.